Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on the Microsoft Office 365 Mailbox Migration Strategies training. My name is Gábor Szatmári. I work as a partner consultant in the partner services for the Central and Eastern Europe region. In this training, I will focus on the migration strategies when migrating mailboxes to the Office 365. Instead of doing a technical deep dive, I will focus on the migration methods and their capabilities, and also talk about the time constraint, and I will explain the user experience too during the migration phase. Let me show you the agenda. So I will start with the planning in general. Then I will walk through the various migration types which are available for this kind of mailbox migration. After we know all the capabilities of these migration types, then I will do some kind of comparison between the various types. And last but not least, I will demonstrate how to use the deployment assistant. So, as promised, let me start with the planning process in general. So, let me show you the big picture first. This is a great overview slide about the migration options available. So let me talk about all these options, but I will tell right now only one sentence about each of the migration types. So first, let me start with the simple migration. So the very first one is called the Outlook or client-based migration. And this migration type is a pretty much based on the client side, and it has a pretty limited performance, which is maximum 0.5 GB per hour. And of course, if you have, for example, a slower internet line with slower upload bandwidth speed, then may have decreased performance while uploading your emails. So if you are looking to the second type of migration, this is called the IMAP migration. IMAP migration is good for all those servers who are speaking the IMAP protocol. And with this IMAP migration, you can migrate your emails through a central migration platform. However, it doesn't migrate your calendars or contact items. If you have an on-premise Exchange server, then you have also some other options. The very first is the cutover Exchange migration. And this cutover migration is typically happens through a one weekend. So it's just like flipping a switch. And it has much more better upload performance, so it's capable to upload the emails with the speed of 5 to 10 GB per hour. Of course, if you have a pretty weak internet line or if you have a pretty weak on-premise Exchange server which is already running at 80% of utilization, then you may expect slower upload speeds. If you want to do this migration not during one weekend, then you have the option to choose the staged Exchange migration, because it can last for a couple of weeks. It has, however, pretty nice requirements, like implementing the directory synchronization with your local on-premise Active Directory. And we have the second group here for the migrations. This is called the hybrid deployment, and basically hybrid deployment is really like a long-term coexistence between your on-premise system and your cloud subscription. And so basically this has great features because it can implement a very good feature set and a very good user experience, because during this coexistence phase the users can collaborate flawlessly cross-premise, so calendaring works, for example. And also, this is the only type of migration where the offboarding is working really, really flawlessly and very easily. And at the bottom, you can see one sentence which is stating that we have another migration solutions which are produced by the migration partners. So I will have then later one slide about the various migration options from different external software companies and partners. Let me talk on the right hand side a little bit, and this is about the supportability. So on the left side of this table you can see what are the systems you are migrating from. So for example you can pick here Exchange 2010, and then you can see what type of migrations are supported with these platforms. And here please notice that the staged migration is not available with Exchange 2010 and Exchange 2013. Yeah. However, you have the option to configure a hybrid environment if you are planning a long-term coexistence with your on-premise system. And of course, I put here some other third-party email servers like Notus Notes or Groupwise, and you can see that basically you have two choices, the Outlook-based migration or the IMAP migration. And of course, again, feel free to choose any of the partner-created migration solutions which are available on the market. So here on the right-hand side, you can see only the Microsoft solutions for this migration. If you prefer a centralized migration because you cannot move all of your users by manual actions, then you can choose from multiple migration types, and the very first one is the IMAP migration. So IMAP migration supports all the source email servers who are able to speak the IMAP protocol. And this migration type is migrating the emails and doesn't migrate the calendars and contacts and other items. If you have an on-premise Exchange server, then again you have multiple choices. The very first one is called the cutover Exchange migration. The name cutover is pointing to the fact that usually this migration can happen through one weekend and you need to migrate all of your users during that period. You can expect a maximum migration performance between 5 to 10 gigabytes per hour. If this migration window is not enough for you for the migration, then you can even run the staged Exchange migration. And for the staged Exchange migration, you have a much longer migration window, so you can migrate your users in groups. This migration type has much better requirements, or I would say much stronger requirements, like implementing the directory synchronization with your on-premise Active Directory. The next one is the hybrid deployment. Hybrid deployment is a long-term coexistence between your on-premise Exchange system and your cloud infrastructure. If you implement this hybrid deployment, then actually your on-premise system and your cloud-based system is working together as it would be one single Exchange organization. So, for example, you will be able to move your users back and forth between these type of organizations. Besides these migration types, you have additional options to search for partner-based solutions. Our partners created and developed a couple of migration tools which can be used also for migrations. On the right hand side you can see a reference table. So you can see here your source server, so you can pick your server here, for example Exchange 2010, and then you can see what types of migrations are supported with this source server. So let me highlight here that, for example, the staged migration is not available for Exchange Server 2010. Also, let me highlight that, for example, the IMAP migration is available for other third-party servers like Domino or Groupwise. So you can use this table when you are planning the migration as a reference. So every migration is slightly different. So what are the most critical informations that you need to collect from the actual customer before you are starting to plan the actual migration. So first, let me talk about the size of the company. So if you have, for example, a small company with only 10 or 20 users, then you might use some kind of manual activities and you don't have to think about scripting and automatizing the processes because it takes a lot of time and a lot of resources to put in. And also you need to clear what are the coexistence requirements. So as I already told, if you are planning to do a cutover migration, for example, then you don't have to worry about coexistence because everything starts and everything happens during one weekend. If you are planning a longer migration, then you need to carefully check what kind of coexistence features are available and what are the requirements by the actual users. Also, the provisioning of the user accounts are one thing that you need to talk about. So basically, again, for the very smallest companies, you can create manually the users. At slightly bigger companies, you can import the users from a CSV file, or also you can rely on the directory synchronization tool. And even you have a couple of other chances for provisioning the users, and especially the bigger companies are implementing some kind of account management software, which is connecting to the local Active Directory to the cloud user accounts. And the source server was also mentioned, and if you remember back to the right-hand table on the previous slide, you can migrate mailboxes from different systems, not just from Exchange, but from other servers like Lotus Notes or Google Mail. And last but not least, the identity management can be different. So the question is, if you want to administer your user accounts using your on-premise tools and on-premise Active Directory, or you are maybe relying on the cloud fully and don't run your local Active Directory, or even single sign-on is coming into the picture. So how the users can log on to the actual systems if you want to implement Active Directory Federation services with single sign-on, or maybe not. Then the users can just save their password in Internet Explorer. So as you can see, these are the most important factors when you are planning the actual migration. So we have already seen the big picture. And then right now, let's start the walkthrough of these migration methods. So I will start first with the simple migration using the Outlook, which is called also the client-based migration. The Outlook side migration is mostly for companies without IT administration. So usually this type of companies have only a limited number of user accounts with some IT knowledge. So basically this whole migration type is built on user actions. So what is the feature that we are using? This is actually the import-export feature from Outlook. So on the screenshot on right hand side, you can see that if you open the menu of Outlook, then you can choose open and export, then import and export. So basically you can export all the mailbox items to one PST file, and you are using this PST file to migrate your data now to the cloud. Every Outlook user has a so-called MAPI profile. This MAPI profile can be administered from the control panel by searching for the mail application. You can see an actual screenshot on the right-hand side from this application. And you can see that this particular Outlook user has a MAPI profile called Outlook, and you can add or remove these profiles using these applications. A MAPI profile includes the connection information to the actual mailbox, as well as the OSD file location, which is used for caching the mailbox content if you are using cached mode in Outlook. And also you can attach PST files to one mappy profile, and you can store also some items there in a PST file. So basically during the migration you will face up with one old mappy profile which is connected to your on-premise server, and you will create one new profile which will connect to the Office 365 mailbox. So here are the steps you need when you are performing this Outlook-based migration. First of all, you need to set up your domain and create your user accounts in Office 365 as well as license these users. Then you can redirect your mail flow by modifying your MX record at your DNS provider. From this point, all the incoming emails will land in the cloud. Then you need to export your existing mailbox data using your current mappy profile to a PST file. Then you need to create a new mappy profile which will be connected to the cloud. After your new mappy profile is set and you started your Outlook with this new mappy profile, you can import your mailbox data from the PST file or only attach this PST file to your new mappy profile. And after that, you can expect that Outlook will start uploading your mailbox data to the cloud. And here again, the maximum throughput is 0.5 GB per hour. So, after the Outlook migration, let me briefly discuss the IMAP migration. IMAP migration is a centralized migration. Basically, we can migrate emails with using this migration type. And it's all about that you have one or more IMAP servers on-premise or maybe one hosted server which can be reached by using the IMAP protocol. And Office 365 is reading out the emails from the IMAP mailboxes using the IMAP protocol and using the predefined IMAP port. This migration type is available not only for Exchange servers but for all type of email servers which can be able to reach through the IMAP protocol. So for example, you can use it even to migrate group-wide systems, local systems, Google systems, or even hosted mailboxes where you don't have any direct access to the system. Again, let's have a look on the overall process flow. Here as well, you need to add your domain and create your users in Office 365. You need to add the licenses to these users. This will actually create the mailboxes for them. Then you can upload a CSV file to the cloud which contains the user data, I mean the user names and passwords. And so the cloud will use this CSV file to connect to your IMAP server. And this process will synchronize up the mailbox contents to the cloud, and you can expect at about 5 to 10 gigabyte per hour performance. Of course, your network bandwidth and your email server performance is highly affecting this value. And this initial email synchronization can last for a couple of days based on the amount of data which need to be uploaded to the cloud. Then at a given point, you are ready to redirect your MX record. So from this step, all the incoming emails will land to the cloud mailboxes. What happens with the emails which arrived while the initial email synchronization is running? No problem, no worries. These emails will be synchronized up again because after the initial email synchronization is complete, we do one incremental synchronization once in 24 hours, so you will not miss any incoming emails through this period. Of course, on the client side, you need to create new mappy profiles in Outlook, and these profiles will connect to the cloud mailbox. Since the cloud mailbox is containing also the mailbox data, which was replicated up to the cloud, the Outlook client will download all the mailbox data and put them into the OST file at the client computer. So this can last for a couple of minutes or couple of hours based on the amount of the data that was stored in the actual mailbox. The next migration type is called the cutover migration. Let me start with the requirements. For a cutover migration, you need to have an on-premise Exchange server. It can be Exchange 2003, 2007, 2010 or 2013. On this Exchange server, you need to enable and configure Outlook Anywhere. Also, you need to have an SSL certificate on your Exchange server, which should come from a publicly available and trusted certificate provider. Basically, some providers can give you trial certificates, and if you are thinking to use this certificate only for the migration period, it could be also a good option to get one trial certificate. You should not implement directory synchronization. If the migration tool is looking to your configuration and it detects that you have a directory synchronization tool, you are performing actually stage migration instead of a cutover migration. And last but not least, your user count, I mean the mailbox count in your on-premise Exchange system, should not be more than 1,000. If you have more than 1,000 mailboxes, then again you need to choose another migration options. So basically, all of these requirements made the cutover migration a good choice for a smaller company. Cutover migration is migrating all your on-premise users, including the delegate configuration and mailbox permissions. When looking to the mailbox items, we are migrating not only the emails, but also the calendar items, the contacts, and the tasks. And basically, how cutover migration works, the Office 365 will read out the users and group membership by using the NSPI interface. Then after that, the cloud is connecting to your on-premise Exchange server using the RPC over HTTPS protocol, which is exactly the same protocol that is used by Outlook Anywhere. So, let's have a look on the process flow. The very first step is to create your Office 365 tenant and add your mail domain. Also, you need to verify your mail domain and prepare and configure your service as you wish. You don't need to create your actual user accounts, however. So, during the initial email sync period, the cutover migration is creating the actual mailboxes in the Office 365 tenant. This initial email synchronization can last for a couple of days. You can safely run it because it will not affect your working users at all. And of course, here you can expect a peak performance of 5 to 10 gigabytes per hour upload speed. But again, here your actual bandwidth of your internet connection can limit this value. Similarly to the IMAP migration, after the initial email synchronization was done, we are performing incremental synchronizations in each 24 hours. And again, these two steps can happen in the very background and users are not affected at all. The first moment when users are affected, when you are creating the new MAPI profiles. So the best practice to do this on a Friday evening, and so you will have the actual weekend to do this big switch, to switch your infrastructure to the cloud. The reason why I'm suggesting to do this MAPI profile creation on Friday evening is that after this change, the Outlook clients are starting to download all the mailbox content. So it can be done through this weekend and you are not facing with a huge peak in a Monday morning. Of course, during the weekend you are ready to redirect your mail flow by changing your MX record. So again, from this point all the incoming emails arrive into the cloud mailboxes. After that, we need to wait at least one incremental synchronization, which will actually synchronize all the incoming emails up to the cloud mailboxes. And since we have changed already the mail flow, the MX record, we will not leave out any incoming email. And last but not least, after you've finished, you can delete this migration batch, which was created when you started the initial email synchronization. And for example, a best practice can be to do and remove this migration batch on Monday. The next migration type is the staged migration. Again, let's have a quick overview of the most important requirements for a staged migration. First of all, you need at least Office 365 M or E plans. Also, you need an on-premise Exchange server. However, here the version is very, very important. Staged migration is available with Exchange 2003 and 2007 only, not available with Exchange 2010 or Exchange 2013. On your on-premise server, you need to enable and configure Outlook Anywhere, and the server must have an SSL certificate, which is from a trusted certificate provider. If you plan to perform staged migration, you need to configure directory synchronization before you are starting the actual migration. And the big advantage of the staged migration, if we are comparing it with the cutover migration, that we are migrating not all users in one step, but we are migrating the users in groups. And these groups are called batches. One batch is defined by uploading one CSV file, and this actual CSV file contains the selected users and passwords which will be migrated in this batch. Staged migration is a full fidelity migration because it migrates not only your emails but also other items in your mailbox like contacts and calendar items. How it works is, in the first step, the users, the groups and the group memberships are replicated to the cloud with using the directory synchronization tool. So after this step, when you are migrating the actual user group by forming a batch of users, then the cloud actually connecting to your on-premise Exchange 2003 or 2007 server with using the RPC over HTTPS protocol. This works just like the very same way as Outlook clients would do when connecting to your on-premise Exchange server. So the cloud is reading out all the actual data from the mailboxes and putting it into the cloud mailboxes. Because we don't move all users in one step, there will be a new phase during the migration. And this is called the coexistence phase, when some of the users are still on the on-premise system and other users are already in the cloud. And this coexistence phase can last also for a couple of days or a couple of weeks. So that's why the user experience is very important. So how it works? First of all, the users can see the very same names in their actual global address list. So there will be no difference. They can pick the actual user, they can send an email to the actual users, regardless of where this actual email user is located. Again, the internal and external mail flow works. Without any big tricks, the staged migration will handle this external and internal mail flow. There are, however, two features which doesn't work. The one is the cross-premise delegate functionality, and the second one is the cross-premise resource booking. So one example for this one, if you are moving the both to the cloud, but you leave his assistant still in the on-premise world. This doesn't work very well. However, pretty easy to fix when you are planning the actual groups of the users, the actual migration batches. Then please keep all these users together, so the delegates and the mailbox owners, and migrate them into the very same batch to the cloud. To better understand the stage migration, again, let's have a walk on the actual process, how it works. So first of all, the very first step is to add your email domain to your Office 365 subscription and verify it. And of course, here you need to set up the actual directory sync tool. This directory sync tool will create the users in Office 365 with using the Active Directory users as a master. Then, you know, you are ready to define the very first batch, and I would recommend to start this batch on one evening. So, how it works? First of all, after you started this batch, then the incoming emails for the selected users are delivered both to their on-premise and to their online mailboxes. And again, here we are performing one initial synchronization, which will synchronize the on-premise and the cloud mailbox for these users, which are included in batch number one. Again, you will create new MAPI profiles for Outlooks, and you can do it at that evening. And I would suggest to leave Outlooks running throughout the night, so they will be ready to download the mailbox data. Because, this can be a couple of gigabytes, and this can happen throughout the night without disturbing all the other users by overwhelming the internet bandwidth. And again, here we have an incremental synchronization methodology, so we perform one synchronization in each 24 hours just to make sure we don't miss any changes, any incoming emails. And if you are ready, if all the emails are replicated up and you finished downloading the emails, you are ready to remove the first batch. And this is not the end yet. So we are ready now to start the next batch. So again, one evening comes, we can start the next batch by uploading the next group of users, and we can do the very same steps again, again, and again. Yeah, so this stage migration can last even for a couple of weeks until we migrated all the users up to the cloud and until all the users are actually using their cloud mailboxes. And after that, we are ready to redirect our mail flow by changing the MX record and pointing to the Office 365 mailboxes. The last migration method implemented by Microsoft is called the hybrid migration. Hybrid migration is available only with on-premise Exchange 2010 and 2013 servers. Also, not all the Office 365 plans containing these features, so you consider to buy e-plans. For this type of configuration, again, you need a public SSL certificate from a trusted certificate provider. For a hybrid migration, you also need to configure directory synchronization tool just to create the actual users and mailboxes and maintain the user data. There is also one frequently implemented feature which is called Active Directory Federation Services. If your client requires to have single sign-on, then you need to implement the Active Directory Federation Service infrastructure. Hybrid migration migrates all your mailbox data, including contacts and calendar items, just like the very same way like a cutover or stage migration. And how it works, here again, we are relying on the directory synchronization tool to synchronize users, groups, and group membership between the local Active Directory and the cloud infrastructure. on the exchange side, we implement a secure mail flow between these two organizations, and also we know that this is an internal mail flow, so it's pretty much secure based on TLS encryption. Also, the sharing like free busy information or internal mail tips is working because these two organizations are working together just like the very same way as if they were one single exchange organization. And here, let me talk a couple of sentences about the MRS, the Mailbox Replication Service. So we are synchronizing the mailbox data using the Mailbox Replication Service. And there is one very big advantage of this replication. Since we don't change the actual ID of the mailbox, Outlook will not download the mailbox data again. So, in contrary to all of the previous migration solutions, we don't need to recreate the MAPI profile and we don't need to recreate the OST file. So that's why the hybrid migration is a perfect choice for bigger companies. Even I can imagine a situation when a big company is decreasing the number of exchange servers from, let's say, 15 exchange servers to one or two exchange servers on-premise. So a couple of users which need special configuration can be still running on the on-premise exchange servers, but the rest of the users are using the cheap cloud mailboxes. And the overall plan for us is to manage both systems, both the on-premise and the cloud system, using the on-premise management tools like Exchange Control Panel or the Exchange Management Console. And let me show here one very good reference slide about the features and how the hybrid migration and the coexistence phase in the stage migration is different. So you can see that, for example, the unified global address list, this is the row number 3. This is the very same in both configuration. However, we have here cross-premise functionality. So if someone is sharing his calendar with an on-premise user while his mailbox is in the cloud, it works. Also, the two organizations understanding that they are internal, they are one organization. So, for example, if email is sent between these two organizations, then it's not scanned by the spam filters. Or even we are able to show mail tips for the internal users. And last but not least, we support the mailbox move to both directions. So it's very easy to onboard one user to Office 365 or offboard one user from the Office 365. So you can just move the users back and forth between the two systems. And the mailbox replication happens in the very background. So the actual user, even if he's getting moved between these two systems, he's able to send and receive emails, and he just needs to restart his Outlook after the mailbox move was finished. So we don't lose productivity time. So you can see with all these features in mind that hybrid migration is really for a long-term coexistence and you can let your email system running together with the cloud. And you can see that actually this is a pretty complex system and mostly this is a good choice for bigger organizations, for bigger enterprises. And this hybrid migration is definitely not for small enterprises who just need to move quickly to the cloud. Okay, so these were the actual migrations available out of the box from Microsoft. So these were the free tools. However, there are a couple of third-party tools. You can see 5 partners here, and basically you can buy these tools from them. So they created migration solutions which can be used by different migration scenarios. of course you need to buy these tools, but considering that you need a pretty complex task or manual task for a given migration, it would worth this extra cost because it would cost not so much resources. So keep in mind and feel free to search for any migration tools which can be found on the internet. But here you can see 5 examples. So we have seen the different migration types, and right now let's compare them with each other. If you remember back to the Outlook-based migration, this contains a lot of manual tasks. You need to visit all the workstations, you need to reconfigure all the workstations, you need to perform the PST export on all the workstations. So this is pretty much a manual task. However, these tasks are pretty easy. So even you can instruct the end users to migrate their own data if they are pretty much educated. And this is very easy to scale up these tasks, so you can pay for, let's say, 10 people who are doing this manual task with each of the mailboxes. So you can scale up this, and since these tasks are pretty easy, most probably you don't have any trouble with these tasks. So that's why I can say the risk profile is very, very low. So you can easily do the migration without having too much risk within it, and you don't run into Easter eggs or bugs or whatever. So this simple migration is really ideal for this type of small organization with approximately 10 or 20 or 30 users maximum. And cutover migration, in the contrary, can handle companies up to 1,000 users. So the very first question from you to the actual customer, how many mailboxes do you have? If he has more than 1,000, then definitely the cutover migration cannot be used. And here we need to think in the migration window. And basically, if it can fit into one weekend, or we can afford a couple of days for this cutover migration, then this can be used. And still, when comparing to the Outlook-based migration, we need to plan pretty much carefully with this cutover migration. We need to coordinate all the events. If you remember back, during that weekend, we will create the new MAPI profiles, we will set up Outlooks, we will change the MX records. So a lot of things happening in the central. But for the users, this is pretty much invisible. Yeah, so we can do pretty much everything for the actual users. So when they arrive back on Monday, they can start working, and they can see the very same tools. They can see their emails in their Outlook mailboxes. So really, from the user perspective, there are not too many tasks to do. And stage migration here allows you a longer coexistence phase. So if you are not ready to finish the actual migration during one weekend, then you can choose this stage migration. So you will be able to perform this migration throughout some weeks and migrate the users in groups, and still the rest of the groups, the rest of the users are not affected at all, so they can continue to work. And so basically you can migrate your organization within steps. That's why it's called the stage migration. And here again we have a numerous task which we need to perform just to make sure that this stage migration will be flawless and we don't affect the users very, very much. Yeah, and again, this is kind of central migration, so we don't expect to have too many tasks on the user side, and the users don't expect to migrate their own content or whatever. Yeah, so here the big difference is in the migration window and the coexistence phase when we are comparing the stage migration with the cutover migration. When to use the hybrid migration? Basically, if your actual customer wants a long-term coexistence between his on-premise exchange system and the cloud system, then the hybrid migration is the perfect and only choice. So this hybrid migration is really a transparent method, a transparent deployment for the actual end users, so they don't have to do anything on the user side. And again, as I told previously, we can move the users back and forth between the two organizations. Here, what we need to make sure that there are complex preparation tasks, and still we need administrators, exchange specialists on the on-premise side, because we still have on-premise infrastructure, pretty complex on-premise infrastructure, and we need to perform pretty complex configuration tasks. So keep in mind, and that's why the hybrid migration is for bigger companies who are planning to do this long-term coexistence and who are planning to run their on-premise exchange servers also in the future. Let me continue with a short demonstration of the deployment assistant, which is a great tool when you are planning your actual migration. The easiest way to find the Microsoft Server Deployment Assistant tool is to search for this keyword on the technet.microsoft.com. You can see that we have an older Exchange Server 2010 Deployment Assistant, which has the older design. Also, you can find a new Exchange Server 2013 Deployment Assistant with the new bluish design. You can see that this deployment assistant can be used to deploy on-premise infrastructure, can be used to deploy a hybrid configuration, or can be used to deploy a cloud-only solution. For this example, let me choose the cloud-only deployment. In the second step, I will confirm that I have some existing mailboxes which need to be migrated. In this step, you need to choose the type of your source server. So if you remember, we do have a migration option for IMAP servers, or we can choose any of the Exchange server versions. Of course, you need to choose the actual one which you have. So right now, for the example, let me choose Exchange Server 2007 and click on Next. You may ask the customer about his plans regarding user account management. Smaller companies might manage their user accounts in Office 365. Bigger companies may implement the directory synchronization tool. So for this example, let me choose manage users in Office 365 only, because I don't want to implement the directory synchronization tool. If you remember back to the requirements of the migration scenarios, you know why is this a very important question. So, if you remember, the cutover migration has a limitation of capable to migrate only 1,000 users. So, if I choose here the option yes, then I will land at a cutover migration. So, this is suggested to me as a good solution in this case. Let me go back to the previous question, just for the example. So what happens if I choose I have more than 1,000 mailboxes? So after I click on Next right now, then I will land at the description of the stage migration. So you can find here a very detailed description of a stage migration, and if I scroll down, you can see that I have step-by-step instructions too. Let me open step number 2. This step is discussing actually the CSV file that you need to create for defining the batches, the groups of the users for the migration. You can see here a couple of important information as well as best practices and an example of a CSV file. if you want this description in a printed format, you can just scroll up to the top and you can print or export out all these steps which can be found in this description. And remember, you are not alone. We, the partner services, are here to help you with proactive advisory questions. So you may visit the partner portal for the exact description of our service. You can contact us in email at the askpts@microsoft.com address. And also feel free to post some of your questions to the support communities, which is monitored by the partner services. Each of the migration types has a detailed description on the outlook.com. You can use this official documentation to get into the details, into the requirements, to the features, and how the migration happens. Let me suggest here a couple of free tools which are available and which can be used in migration scenarios. The very first one is the Exchange Remote Connectivity Analyzer, which can be used to test your on-premise Exchange configuration before the actual migration, so you can easily identify misconfigurations or any firewall troubles. I think the title of the Exchange Client Network Bandwidth Calculator is pretty much self-explanatory, and the last one is the PST Capture Tool. This PST Capture Tool can help to collect the PST files used by the actual users and can be used to upload the data stored in PST files to the cloud mailboxes. During this course, we discussed the migration methods which are available if you are migrating your on-premise system to the cloud. So you have the choice. You can see some of them are perfectly fit to the small organization. Some of them perfectly fit to the larger organization. Again, you have the choice, choose the right one. Thank you for watching this recording, and see you soon on other recordings created by partner services.